It took about a century of debates and fights and threats of provincial separation to finally get us to a place, or at least to get Ottawa to a place, where it felt it could impose a form of equalization, a system of kind of Robin Hood, taking from the rich and giving to the poor, to see if we couldn't balance things out in this country so that everybody would have relatively equal access to services. Mary Janigan, a journalist, an author, historian, academic, has really focused on this issue in two books. Her most recent, The Art of Sharing, and this is The Richer Versus the Poorer Provinces Since Confederation. I love this line, the untold story of how Ottawa tackled fiscal inequalities among resentful provinces. A bit pejorative, but very accurate. So we'll hear from Mary in just a moment. I want to introduce our other guest, Trevor Toome. He is a professor of economics at the University of Calgary, research fellow at the School of Public Policy. He is an academic who has, in the end, as we get close to the referendum, taken a stand on the referendum on equalization in Alberta. Basically, it doesn't much matter how these votes go because it is enshrined in the Constitution, this concept of equalization, and it would take the rest of the country to say no to end it. So it's going to be there. And furthermore, he argues it should be, that it's a good idea. So this is where we're going to start this conversation. It's going to be, you know, you've got to care about how this country functions. So let's start with you, Mary. I mean, basically, you've said this is a foundational concept. If we didn't have this, it would be hard to imagine this country.
That's correct. It took 90 years for Ottawa to bring in equalization. 1956, it passed. 57, it took effect. During those 90 years, the provinces squabbled. The richer ones resented federal subsidies. The poorer ones wanted bigger subsidies. At the center of the argument was, are the provinces to be treated as equal entities, or should there be equity among them? And this issue only became serious when we got into the 1950s and started bringing in national social programs. And if we didn't have those programs, hospital care, medical care, we wouldn't have a nation, and we couldn't have brought them in unless Ottawa did it unilaterally without ensuring that the poorer provinces could join in and pay their share of these really quite vital programs.
The other thing that you've noted, which I found really interesting, is that most Western countries have some kind of equalization scheme, call it what you will, with the exception of the United States. And that it makes your point. If you look at some states, there's very poorly funded education systems, for example, which make it very difficult for people to be, you know, folks to be considered for jobs if they're not considered well-educated.
I know. The United States is the only major developed nation that does not have some form of equalization. And it's really quite sad. They do have other forms of distribution. You can, for example, get grants for specific areas. Right. Defense contractors, it's argued, when congressmen began arguing about the location of bases, they are really saying they want more federal money put into their state.
Right.
The fact is, most countries that any country that's developed that doesn't have equalization usually falls apart. It needs that kind of link amongst the various entities in the federation. It's vital.
Trevor, I'm assuming that you, while maybe coming at it from a different point of view, agree with that concept.
Yeah, and I think Mary's historical perspective here is very enlightening. About, we do need to understand where the program came from to fully appreciate the role that it plays, and it needing to have been brought in at the same time as we were ramping up public health and education, you know, quite expensive public services that are delivered at the province level. You know, this the a program like equalization, whatever it's called, facilitates that degree of decentralized delivery of public services that we have in Canada. And the rationale for that program does, you know, remain quite strong today, given how large the differences are between provinces in terms of their underlying economic strength and demographics.
There's kind of changing evidence on that, or maybe you would know best, I'll ask it as a question, that in fact the differences between the richer and the poorer are getting less in this country. That may be a result of equalization, or it just may be how the, you know, you see a rich province, once rich like Alberta, becoming less so because of what's happening to energy. What's your assessment of that?
So if you look at the broad, long-run trajectory of provincial economies in Canada, for you can go back to the 1920s to do this kind of fairly systematically, and you do see, indeed, a very strong and clear convergence of provincial economies. So the gaps today are less than they have been historically. And interestingly, COVID did have a much greater economic cost on the higher income provinces. So we don't yet have the full data, but it does look like 2020 is going to be a year where these inequalities across provinces really contract quite a bit. But they're still there. So even the most recent data prior to COVID, you have the level of GDP, right, roughly the amount of income generated in Alberta per person, about $80,000 compared to something almost half that in the Maritime provinces. So the gaps do still remain of a meaningful magnitude.
First to you, Trevor, and then I'm going to go back to Mary for the historical piece, but the biggest knock on equalization these days is that it's just not fair, that the richer provinces have to contribute more than the poorer provinces. And Alberta will say, you know, if Quebec didn't subsidize its energy, its hydro costs, we wouldn't have to send them so much money. That's just a policy choice they've made. And why are we being forced to do that? Mm-hmm. And the second issue is really that the feds don't have to negotiate about this. And we just saw this federal government do this a couple of years ago, which is we're extending the same deal for 5 years. Too bad. So sad. No discussion.
Yeah. So on the issue of fairness, this is, you know, like fairness in everything is in the eye of the beholder. And so reasonable people will disagree on what they value or what objectives they're trying to achieve. But, you know, at a practical level, formula design details do indeed matter quite a bit for some provinces. So often in Alberta, we hear calls to, for example, remove resource revenues. That's a very long-standing position of the government of Alberta. If it were to be removed, actually, then Newfoundland and Labrador would be receiving significant sums through the program this year. And so for them, those kind of questions about whether the formula is designed appropriately to reflect the fiscal circumstances that different provinces find themselves in, you know, one could legitimately think about fairness in that sense. In terms of funding the program, like a very common concern in Alberta, especially as we lead into the referendum, is the amount of federal revenue that's raised from taxpayers that live in Alberta. The Premier quite frequently citing a very accurate and true statistic that the gap between revenue and spending of the federal government in Alberta is roughly $20 billion per year in recent years. And that's pretty significant. And some may point to that as Alberta receiving less than its fair share of the federal financial resources. I think it is important to remember, though, that this is largely driven by income differences. And we deliberately raise more revenue from higher income individuals. And that can raise fairness concerns among some, but that would be less about redistribution across regions than between higher income individuals to low.
Mary, this was the big point in the discussion about on what basis would you decide who needs to be equalized, who needs the revenue? Would you look at what the province takes in terms of taxes? Would you look at who needs it more? How did they come to that in 1956 and 1957?
They had long discussions at Cabinet. They looked at earlier attempts to bring in some kind of equalization formula. They looked very hard at Australia, which had equalization from 1933. They looked at what a Royal Commission recommended in 1940 for Canada. In the end, it was thought to be too intrusive to start looking at how governments spend their money. So they simply wanted to look at what revenues governments could raise. And the only one that's actually based, the only indicator that's actually based on what a province takes in is the resource revenue. They count 50% of it. The others are really a national average. And so Alberta is assumed to have a sales tax, for example.
Even though they don't.
They don't. What struck me throughout the whole debate is that the referendum is asking for the principle of equalization to be removed. But, you know, there are so many things, other things that could be done. Now, presumably, they think if they pass this referendum, the formula will be adjusted. First of all, you're quite right. The Liberals did blow it when they unilaterally renewed the formula in 2019. And secondly, there's still more that could be done to fix the formula. Right now, the pot of money is growing linked to GDP. There's a craziness in the assumptions that can never be wholly fixed because it is a question of balance. But I would have loved the feds to try more.
The formula suggests that the spending has to, on equalization, but by its very nature, the spending has to keep increasing, even though needs may decrease. Like, this is kind of a crazy way to approach it, Mary.
Well, they look at income taxes, corporate, personal, property taxes, resource revenues, and consumption, I think. Nobody really knows how they calculate it. It's all quite secret. They won't reveal it. But, you know, it is a project that could be done and could be fixed. You don't have to throw out one of the most important linkages that keep the country together in order to reform a formula. Mm-hmm. You don't.
I guess, and I want to come back to you, Trevor, because that's kind of the question for me, which is, and you raised COVID because lots of money was dumped into provinces because people needed that money. They couldn't use the equalization system. It's too cumbersome. You have to look at what's gone on for the last 5 years before you decide what to do. And by then it's out of date. So do we need other mechanisms? You know, we have a stabilization fund and some other things. Or should we take a lesson from COVID, which is when there's a need, the bureaucracy actually moved quite quickly. Maybe we should just do it that way.
I think there will be a lot of lessons that we learned from COVID in so many areas, for sure. And I do agree that we did learn some lessons about fiscal arrangements. And personally speaking, I do hope that we look back and think about some redesigns for some of these programs. Now, equalization, it does have this five-year lag before everything is fully worked into the formula. And this is in part some data lags. We do need to wait until November of this year, for example, to know what fully happened last year in terms of provincial economies. But then the including multiple years and averaging them is a deliberate choice to stabilize payments to improve predictability for provincial government budgets. So it's meant not to be a rapid response program, but something to deal with more persistent structural problems. And I think that's fair that it can maintain that role. But then stabilization, this other program, is explicitly meant to be a quick support for provinces, any province that experience a sharp and sudden decline in revenues. It's kind of like an insurance program for provincial revenues that they can apply for. And that has been reformed a little bit due to COVID. Lots of, I think, some early concerns about whether every single province would qualify under that program. It doesn't look like that'll be the case anymore, thankfully, but they did enlarge it, making it a little bit bigger. It's still fairly modest, I must say. And so there's some scope for conversations there, absolutely. But yeah, as we come out the other side of COVID, we should be taking a look at these programs, as we should many others, from EI to general income support programs and how they work and whether they're sufficient.
What's the incentive for, and to you, Trevor, on this, what's the incentive for the provinces in Ottawa, both of them, to do the right thing? Because that's the problem. Alberta thinks that, you know, it is getting a raw deal, and they actually have a fair point on Quebec subsidizing hydro. I mean, that's a reasonable point. It's just that they kind of mesh other things into the discussion about this transfer system. What would be, I mean, looking at all what Ottawa's behavior and just saying, you know, no negotiation, we're going to do this. What would make them act? You know, it comes to this basic question of, and why have a referendum? Why can't we just have discussions about this stuff? It's how the country functions.
So I guess I'm in part a hopeless optimist in that I look back at a lot of big reforms that Canada has done federally and provincially and in big areas. And the incentive, I think, among many politicians is because they are there for the right reasons. And sometimes politics does lead to more combative, polarized communications at the very least. At the end of the day, we've seen changes even recently to the Canada Pension Plan, for example, where provincial and federal governments got together unanimously and territorial governments of all parties and agreed to a really material change in that program. And indeed, in the 90s, setting up the Canada Pension Plan in the way that it is today was a world-leading, an incredibly large undertaking that was successfully done. And now also, indeed, equalization. The formula that we have today reflects a lot of hard work by an expert panel appointed under former Prime Minister Paul Martin, who reported to the then Prime Minister Stephen Harper, who largely implemented the recommendations of the panel. And so that's also a very large and significant change to the nature of federal provincial transfers in Canada. And so I'm quite hopeful that despite the elevated tensions that the referendum does, you know, unquestionably create, deliberate or not, that's one consequence of the referendum, that as the dust settles from COVID, governments will be able to engage on these tough questions and make some sensible but potentially just gradual reforms.
Mary, put this in some historic context for us, because of course, as we noted, premiers were threatening separation way back when. Alberta's question in this referendum reflects the question that Quebec asked. And basically they're saying, well, look at everything that Quebec has gotten because of its threats to separate. We're in a very, I mean, COVID has kind of changed it dramatically, but we're in a very difficult time. Politics, not just in this country, but everywhere. Can you situate us where we are? Is this a phase we're going through, or are we fundamentally changing?
I think that equalization...
You can do another book on it after you've answered the question.
What has been remarkable is how equalization has always been controversial from the beginning. It was brought in to try and stop threats of secession in the Maritimes in the 1920s, threats of secession in BC was muttering in the 30s and 40s. And of course, the prairies were in terrible shape. Equalization comes in and it immediately helps to lose the election for Louis Saint-Laurent, the prime minister. Ontario Premier Leslie Frost campaigned against Saint-Laurent, partly based on what he didn't think was a fair share of the taxes collected in his province. The Maritimes voted in a large way against Saint-Laurent because they didn't think they had enough money yet. These controversies rise and fall and rise and fall. Although I must say, I think that the Alberta referendum could have quite serious repercussions unless politicians behave sensibly, as as Trevor hopes. This could be partly because its focus is almost surreptitiously against Quebec in particular, even though Quebec gets much less per capita in terms of equalization than the Maritimes. It's just, it's an unspoken thread that makes me very uneasy.
And they said no to the pipeline, and that is a thread in this debate. There's no question.
Yes. Yes. I can see it. I had a lunch today with a woman whose brother came from Alberta for a week. And she said she couldn't believe how furious he was. He was furious with Ottawa. He was angry. And he didn't even really understand equalization. But she said he was going to vote for the referendum because something had to be done. And this was a safety valve to express. Now, it's quite clear that equalization will continue after the referendum vote. As Trevor pointed out, the feds can just keep sending money. It's their money. They have the spending power. But something is going to have to be addressed, even if there is a negative vote. Do you agree?
Well, I certainly do. And I'm just going to cite back to you, Mary, your earlier book, Let the Eastern Bastards Freeze in the Dark, The West versus the Rest Since Confederation. I mean, we were all, you and I were covering the NEP, and that was Alberta's message to Eastern Canada. You don't want this energy. You don't have to have it. You can freeze. That they did come to some kind of deal on that, and it was saved. But I agree that we're at that kind of point again. I don't know, Trevor, what do you think?
No, I do agree, and I'm worried about rising tension between Alberta and Ottawa in particular. But I guess I find it difficult to predict where things will go, because I think in part some of the frustration does reflect domestic factors within Alberta, not just federal policy concerns, but it's been a real challenging few years from low oil prices and a recession, and an incredibly deep recession too, with the economy contracting in terms of the amount of income that it generates by about 20% between 2014 and 2016. So that's very large and really
huge.
It's really hard to overstate the significance of that and the 130,000 job losses from peak to trough. And so there's just deep frustration about a lot of things. And then the provincial budget here is also in a really difficult situation where there's really no reasonable way around the fiscal constraints in the province without either lower public services or lower public sector compensation or higher taxes. And so there's significant burdens that will need to be felt somewhere and potentially broadly in order to address those budget concerns. So I think in part the government is, I guess, helping redirect some of that frustration towards Ottawa. And if it's just as a shorter term political tactic, then it may not build in the coming years. So I guess.
But I don't know how we avoid that when the predominant conversation in Ottawa is the climate crisis, and the predominant conversation in a big chunk of this country, not just Alberta, is about the energy sector. Mm-hmm. And of course, change is coming, but there's still a 25, 30 year lifespan, and we can't just declare it dead.
Exactly. And that's where I think that rhetoric really does matter federally, where taking climate seriously does not mean shutting down the energy sector, right? Yeah. It means having policies that think about long-term objectives, like real policies that ratchet up in stringency. It means promoting innovation in the industry as well to lower emissions of the oil and gas that is produced here. Because even the Canada Energy Regulator in its forecasts out to 2050, even under scenarios where you have significant global action on climate, you have production of a significant amount of oil and gas in Alberta, less than would otherwise have been the case, but still 3-4 million barrels per day being produced even decades from now. And so that balance between these competing objectives is very important, and very important to get right in the language that we use. So it's not about rejecting climate action, and it shouldn't be about shutting down the energy sector. It should be about being open about trade-offs and options and pros and cons of different choices, and then having governments hopefully facilitate that public conversation in a way that gets broad buy-in, because they're difficult choices for sure.
That's the question, and I'll come back to it again with Mary, which is somebody has to do the right thing here. You've covered politics for a long time before you chose the academic route. I think Trevor's more optimistic than most people are about the ability to do that. What do you think about the politics of it?
I honestly think it's very dangerous. And I would like to see Ottawa react, the Liberal government react with some degree of sensitivity and wisdom to what is, if it does turn into a yes vote, what is a cri de coeur.
Yeah.
And the anger has to be addressed, and they have to find a way to address both equalization and, as Trevor notes, other factors that are creating the worry. I fret about this as much as I did about the possibility of Quebec separation.
Yeah.
It requires a sensitive vote. And I worry that instead the rhetoric has been raised on each side. Mm-hmm. Equalization helps Alberta too. It doesn't have millions of people moving to Alberta for better health care or better education. It also allows the provinces to provide good services without the feds having to stand over their shoulder and set more conditions. I worry.
Yeah. I think, and so much of your writing reminds me, and this is a compliment of Sandra Gwynne's history of how politics works and the history of our country and what was going on in the salons and the back rooms. And you have injected an awful lot of that color. But I guess I'm going to ask it this way, which is, do you see the leadership required? And I'm provincially, federally, it doesn't matter, in the industry, are you seeing the kind of leadership we need to save and build a country?
I think the industry has been far more sensible than the politicians. The industry is taking steps to address climate change.
Yeah.
I am quite distressed by Jason Kenney, who was a fine minister in Ottawa, becoming someone who was focusing so much anger on Ottawa now. I think it's a dangerous political game. And I would like to see the Liberal government show leadership in this.
I know.
Not raising my hope.
I think everybody feels that same way, just that frustration and the hope. Please do something.
It feels, I doubt that they have the capacity to do it, but I'd like them to surprise me. Perhaps the finance minister could step in with equalization. I would have more faith in her than most.
With Alberta. So, Trevor, to you, what do you see a chance that this is actually, we're somehow going to either keep Humpty Dumpty together or we're going to find a way to put them back together?
So I think we will see some changes to some of the transfer programs. And I think we have gone through very difficult moments throughout Canadian history. And so coming out the other side of those in one piece suggests that we will again. I think demographic pressures are going to be mounting considerably over this decade and the next decade. And that's going to
really
be very
interesting point in terms
very unevenly distributed pressures in different parts of the country. So Atlantic Canada in particular, Newfoundland and Labrador especially. And that alone, putting aside the kind of equalization concerns in general. The demographics alone are going to need to have a big rethink in terms of the health and social transfers, and indeed even equalization. And COVID is a moment to think big about changing some of these transfers, because it has been a big shock that has revealed some of the shortcomings even of the equalization program. Mm-hmm. And so we're going into a time now where the last major change to the formula back in 2009, and even that was not even major. So the last major one was 2007. This is a stretch of time where the formula has remained largely in place. That's really second only to the 1982 through to the early 2000s period. So it's due for a good rethink and another look, as every major policy issue should be regularly examined and tweaked and reformed as economic, fiscal, social circumstances change.
You write these books, Mary, and even as we were beginning our conversation today, we were kind of joking amongst ourselves that, you know, the geeks, this is a serious podcast for geeks, right? Which is equalization. What? Because it just has become a shorthand for an awful lot of concerns about the state of the Federation, whether or not it's actually just that. It's shorthand for a lot of stuff. So we do have to take it, seriously. Do we really need to understand more, or do we just have to get to work fixing it? Somehow, if we studied all the history and knew what Louis Saint-Laurent went through and what would it make us smarter?
It might make us wiser, I hope. Both books were about respect, on the theme of respect amongst governments. In the West case, they didn't get resource control, unlike all the other provinces, until 1927 at a conference. And even then, by the time they actually fully got resource control, they couldn't afford the resources because the Depression had hit. In equalization, I think that it's too often tagged as something that is unfair, and understanding how it came to be can lead us to understand. We have to know that it kept Canada together. It solved the problems of the 50s. But, you know, I think Trevor has suggested that there could be, for example, the major social transfers for health and social policy, they're per capita. And I think Trevor has suggested you could look at changing that approach, certainly to the health transfer, because Newfoundland has an aging population, not enough tax funds, and the strains on their healthcare system are enormous right now.
Well, that's exactly what we saw in COVID. I mean, it's not that we didn't know it, but we actually saw the provinces that had aging populations and why they got slammed so dramatically with the issues in old folks' homes.
That's true. And it's going to have to change. I resisted initially the idea of linking those per capita transfers to other factors such as demographics. But I suspect it's the way that Ottawa's looking, and I suspect it's the way we have to go.
In terms of changing that formula and this tie that binds.
Yes, and the way that the equalization formula increases automatically now.
Yeah, I know, that's such a crazy thing. We could spend an hour trying to explain why that's dumb. Trevor, you've got this equalization tool, and I mean, seriously, this is really for geeks. So you can go online and you can actually feed in different things, like if Quebec did this, what would happen? And if Alberta had a sales tax, what would happen? Tell us a little bit about where to find it in case people actually want to go and look.
Right. Well, I'm glad you brought it up. Definitely, it is a tool for geeks, for sure. And I did originally design this, and anyone can check it out at financesofthenation.ca/equalization. And the entire equalization program, like every I is dotted and T is crossed in there. So all the bells and whistles, you can tweak the dials and see what payments would be using the actual data. And I think Mary earlier on noted that the actual data is hard to come by, which is indeed true. So we did get permission to have what's on that simulator released on that site. And I think aside from just geeks or maybe students taking a public finance course whose instructor has assigned them equalization, this has value beyond the wonks and the students and the geeks as well, because it does reveal, I think, how what is typically seen as a complicated program, how it actually operates, how it tops up provinces with lower levels of fiscal capacity, lower average incomes, how you can change resource revenues to see what happens to payments. In Alberta, it's often referenced that if we had a sales tax, we would receive equalization payments. And so you can turn the dial on Alberta's sales tax and see what happens. And spoiler alert, not a lot happens. So it's nice to also go back and see other years. So there's multiple years that are there. I have a projection for what COVID might mean next year, which I'm sure will be proved obsolete fairly soon when the actual data comes out, but hopefully it's a valuable tool to open what is typically this black box, which is the equalization program.
Yeah. And then you really, really, really should read Mary's books, because they're not just about this. It is about the history of the country. And, and I think that's your point, Mary. We can't separate that.
Thank you.
Yeah. But we can't really separate the history of this country without understanding how and where this came from.
Do you know, Alberta received equalization at the beginning. All the provinces did except Ontario. And then, of course, the time came when...
In the market crash, yeah.
Well, various things turned and they kept adding factors, and Alberta ended up not receiving it anymore. But... this has been a vitally important program for all provinces. Even Ontario received it.
Yeah, and might again in the next little bit. Thank you both very much. I think it's really a little perspective in what we're dealing with here. And again, it's not really about the referendum. It's about how we do politics and keep our country functioning. And I really thank you for that. Look, Mary Janigan, journalist, author, historian, academic, friend. Her latest book, The Art of Sharing, The Richer Versus the Poorer Provinces Since Confederation. And go back and read Let the Eastern Bastards Freeze in the Dark, too, because that really is actually even more relevant again as we go through this round. And Trevor Toom, we've done that. Finances of the Nation, all one word, right? So people can go and can look at that. And Trevor, of course, is at the University of Calgary, professor of economics, and a fellow at the School of Public Policy. Thank you both very much.
Thank you. It was great to be here.
Yes. Talk to you soon. That's it for our podcast today on equalization in Canada. Now, don't you feel smarter? We'll see you again soon. Thanks.
Bye.